So this is actually indeed a bodhisattva, which is what the topic of this conversation will be. So what exactly is a bodhisattva? A bodhisattva is a being who has achieved enlightenment, but delays its exit from the cycle of rebirth to guide others. I use the word it very, very carefully, because bodhisattvas are supposed to be genderless. They're not supposed to be a male or a female figure, although the way that they are represented tend to be a little bit more masculine than feminine. We will see exceptions in other bodhisattvas we talk about. But, so this is an example of a bodhisattva sculpture from China. This is a bodhisattva sculpture from modern-day Pakistan. That would be Gandharan. That's probably one of the earlier depictions of a bodhisattva, probably around the first or second century. This is a Tibetan depiction of a bodhisattva, and this is a Korean depiction of a bodhisattva. And there's one thing that we see in common with all of them, and that is the crowns on their heads, the jewelry that they wear around their necks, and the relatively fancy clothes compared to what a Buddha might wear. So if you are looking at a deity and they are wearing jewelry around their necks and a crown on their head, there's a good chance that is most likely a bodhisattva rather than a Buddha. Yes?
But the first picture that you showed us, he wasn't wearing anything on his head.
That is a very, very good observation, and that is something we're actually going to deal with. He's actually the first bodhisattva we'll talk about in this presentation. And he's kind of a special exception. One thing that I found studying this field is that there's always an exception that will completely change the way you think. And you know, you might think you understand something, and all of a sudden there's that exception, and you're like, oh, well, never mind then. Back to square one. So, yeah, they all do have this binary, and that's more so of a reference to the origins of Buddhism with Siddhartha Gautama, who was born a prince, born in wealth, and decided to give up that wealth to search for truth, to search for enlightenment. So this bodhisattva that we were looking at was Jizo, and he is probably one of the only bodhisattvas, if not the only bodhisattva, who does not wear a crown on his head or jewelry around his necks in most cases. I'll say in most cases a lot because, you know, just to cover my bases. So, he originated in India as Kachitagarbha, and he moved through China, he moved through Korea, and the cult of Jizo ended up in Japan around the 7th century. And he is a bodhisattva that is... His intent is to go into the hells and to save the souls of people who are suffering or beings who are suffering in these six realms of existence. Now, the six realms of existence, they are also known as the six realms of rebirth, and they are the realms in which you are born depending on your karmic gains or losses. So, for example, if I did lots of bad things during this life, I might be in the realm of humans right now, but if I were to do a bunch of bad stuff, gain bad karma, I would be reborn as a lower form. Depending on the sins that I committed, I would maybe be reborn as a hungry ghost, or I might be reborn as an animal, or I might be reborn as a hellish being. And this cycle of rebirth is something that is distressing to a lot of people. They don't want to be reborn as a hellish being. They don't want to be reborn as something that is perpetually hungry. They want to be reborn as in a better realm, which is, you know, unfortunate for humans because the only step up from being a human is being a celestial being. So the first realm of existence is the celestial beings. These are characterized by beings who exist in the celestial cosmos. and their level of suffering, because yes, even celestial beings can suffer in the Buddhist cosmos, their suffering is due to pride. They know that they live forever, they know that they are celestial beings, that they know they are the highest realm of existence. And so they have this feeling of pride. And then they become bored. And their emotions are high, you know, they're very proud and very happy, but equally as strong are their feelings of depression and loneliness. And eventually, after 40,000 years, 50,000 years, they will pass away, and then their karmic gains or losses will be held against them. The next realm of existence is humans, Nindo. So I'm sure there's a Nintendo joke in there somewhere. But that is the realm of existence that we are in currently. So as I mentioned before, we only have one step up. The only one higher than us is celestial beings. Our weakness, our realm of suffering is characterized by desire. The thing that stops us from achieving enlightenment is our desires. And that's what Jizo is coming into the realm of humans to keep us, to steer us away from. Stay away from your desires and, you know, focus on the final goal, which is enlightenment. The third realm of existence is the asuras, or asuras. And in asura, though, it is occupied by demigods. Why they rank lower than humans, I really have no idea. But that's how this comes down. They are beings that are more prone to violence, more prone to aggression, to argument. They're fierce, they're terrifying beings. And their realm of suffering is their constant state of quarrel with each other. The Chikushodo is the realm of animals. And this is the realm of stupidity and servitude. And it's not my words, it's the words that I was given by the research I did. I wouldn't use the word stupid. But, so animals, they don't have a mind of their own. They aren't able to logically think through things. And so their suffering is at the hands of those they serve. And if the ones that they serve are causing harm to them, that is their suffering there. And Jizo, his role is to come in there and deliver the animals from that into the Western paradise. Yes?
If they have no consciousness of their doing good, how do they achieve a higher realm on the next rebirth?
Well, it's living up to their roles as that specific animal. If you're a scarab beetle, your role is to collect dung and roll it and keep the ground clean. And so a good scarab beetle would do that. A bad scarab beetle would, you know, instead go off and eat some leaves or something like that. So, and then for a dog, loyalty to the master. Serve doing a role that a dog would serve. And you build up your karmic nature like that. Fulfilling your roles as that animal. The Gakido, hungry ghosts. This is a realm that is replete with suffering, starvation, agonizing hunger, always looking for something to fill your belly, but never ever being able to satisfy your hunger. And then finally, the hellish beings, and this is just torment. This is torture, this is torment, this is aggression against everything and everybody. You are not going to get out of there unless you have Jizo to help you. And that's why Jizo is such a beloved figure in the realm of Bosatsu, is because he's a being that is willing to face the kings of hell and the actual state of the underworld just to be able to rescue the beings that are there. Yes?
I would imagine most of the Buddhas and stuff basically started in this cycle as humans. Are there any stories about any being that went through all six of these stages?
Not off the top of my head. I can't recall anybody that's done that. But there are stories that refer to them in plays or in morality stories that come out of Buddhism. Buddhist scriptures. The Jatakas, the the stories of the past manifestations of the Buddha before he was the historical Buddha. There are also references to him dealing with different realms of the hells and different realms of suffering. So Jizo Bosatsu, like I said before, he's very beloved. He's a patron bodhisattva of pretty much anybody who deals with realms of fire, children are in there. He is beloved by all. He is not fearsome. He is not scary. He's a kind, a benevolent being because he cares enough to descend to the... Yes?
And he always has bare head?
Almost always, yes. Almost always. Sometimes you'll see images where his head is covered with a piece of cloth or a hat of some kind, but for the most part, bald head, yes. Yeah. So I'm actually going to be talking about that a couple slides from now. So that's something I really thought would be important to stress. Yeah.
On all the Buddhas, I noticed they were all almost always on pedestals of lotus leaves.
Mm-hmm.
And in the first few that you showed us, none of them were on lotus leaf pedestals. Now, these three that you just pulled up, they are they from a particular area that would suddenly pull that lotus leaf image back into the art?
For the most part, they would be on lotus leaf pedestals. This one probably is sitting on a lotus leaf pedestal. They've just edited out of the image. For the most part, almost every Buddhist image that you see and every deity you see will sit on a lotus pod or a lotus flower, just because it is such an iconic plant to the existent, to Buddhist practitioners. I mean, this is a plant that starts in the mud, at the very bottom, the silty, muddy, disgusting bottom of a lake, and it grows out of the ground, and then it becomes this beautiful flower.
Symbolic.
And it's very symbolic of the Buddhist practitioner's journey to becoming a full, beautiful being. So the bald head, I'm glad you touched on that. That's one of the identifying features of a Jizo Bosatsu. Another identifying feature is his left hand. He is holding what is called a wish-fulfilling jewel. And that is a jewel that, as its name suggests, fulfills the wishes of anybody who calls upon that jewel, but also might call upon Jizo to make the wish on their behalf. One other thing, because we're talking about the red bib and the red hat later on, pay attention to these sleeves. These very, very large sleeves, that's something that features a little bit later in about the story with the red bib and the red hat. The other thing is his clothing. He is the only, and I'll put quotes around that, the only bodhisattvas that appears in monk-like clothing as opposed to princely finery. Sometimes he will be holding in one hand a staff. Sometimes it is a staff of the sun. Sometimes it is a just an ordinary staff that might be affiliated with a Buddhist ritual. But if you see a bodhisattva with a bald head holding a staff, most likely Jizo. And Jizo, he also features, remember last month we talked about the welcoming descent, how the Buddhas might come down from the heavens to welcome those who recently passed? Because Jizo features so prominently in the Pure Land, a sect of Buddhism, he also sometimes will appear beside Amida, sometimes he'll appear with Amida, Kanon and Seishi, so you've got a group of four coming down, or you'll even have the Jizo Raigo, where it's only Jizo coming down on the cloud. That one is exceptionally rare in painting, but you do see it every once in a while.
So
yes?
The Jizo as a statue form.
Yes.
People can pray for deceased ancestors go to the next ring or rebirth to be better.
Yeah.
But I mean, animals couldn't come and pray here, or hungry goats couldn't come here.
No.
A human has to do it.
Yeah, a human would have to do it, yeah.
So this would be statues in, say, in Buddhist temple or in the, somewhere.
Yeah, so
Yeah,
the images aren't only found in temples. They're actually Jizoa sculptures are actually found everywhere. In little shrines, sometimes they're just found in little gardens underneath a overhanging tree. Jizoas
cemetery.
Yeah, in cemeteries especially.
Yes.
Because Jizo is very closely affiliated with the Ten Kings of Hell, and when the souls are being judged, Jizo will sometimes play an intercessory role to speak on behalf of those that just recently deceased. So that's why you see a lot of Jizo imagery in cemeteries.
So the living person will pray to Jizo for their deceased ancestors?
Exactly, yeah. And for even people that, you know, they don't really know, but they'll still beseech them to, you know, extend the love to extend that sort of cessation of suffering to everybody, not just to those they love, but to everybody.
Okay.